Caffrey? Is that the way you say it?
It's like coffee that's free. Caffrey.
Coffee.
Yeah, yeah.
Coffee. You don't pronounce really the R?
No, it's in there. Caffrey.
Oh, Caffrey. Yeah. Okay. So Caffrey J.
Uh-huh.
He is, I would say, a singer. Hip hop is singing, isn't it?
Well, I would call it rapping. That's our cultural name for it. It's rapping.
A rap.
Yeah,
it's a rap.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
All right. And thank you, first of all, for being here.
Right on, right on.
Okay.
Thank you for having us.
Okay. So you have a band with you?
Well, I'm in a group called B-Pos, short for Be Positive. We've been rapping since about 2004 in the Bay Area.
Hey.
We've been in about 38 states rapping. I also rock solo under my name, Caffrey J. And I'm also the founder and executive director of Hip Hop for Change. It's a local 501c3 that uses grassroots activism to educate people about socioeconomic injustices and raise funds for marginalized communities. So if it's hip hop, if it's activism, I do it.
Wow, you're awesome. So basically, there's something behind your hip hop singing. It's a message?
Yeah, well, I mean, when you think of hip hop, hip hop is just expression, you know? It's expression in a certain culture. So when it comes to the way we speak, it's rapping. When it comes to the way we dance, it's break and crump, things like that. When it comes to the way we paint, it's graffiti, stenciling, things like that. So it's a whole culture. And with any kind of expressive form, you're trying to express something. I think a lot of people get caught up with this media narrative where, you know, we see this homogenous depiction of hip hop where it's all about, you know,
dancing,
sex, drugs, and money.
Isn't it about dancing too?
Yeah, well, that's our form. It's called breaking, you know.
Do you break dance?
Very badly. Hip Hop for Change does teach a class, a workshop. We've taught 3,000 students in 50 different schools in the last 2 years. And in that course, we actually pay local breakers to come in and teach the kids how to do 6 or 7 moves. So now, just teaching that class with these folks, I know about 6 or 7 moves, but I'm bad at it. So, yeah, not my thing. I dance with my words.
Really?
Yeah.
So, tell me a little bit. So, you've been doing this, you say, since 2000?
Well, I've been in my group B-Pos since 2004. I've been a rap artist since I was probably 15 or so. I'm 34 now,
oh,
so it's
like
been a
it.
Long time.
So, you like doing it?
Well, yeah, it's how I express myself. You know, I'm also an artist as well. I do ceramic sculpture, but I think what resonates with me most deeply in my epigenetic cultural memory is hip hop, you know, is that type of movement.
What is you say social issues? What is your issue that you are most keen of?
White supremacy. Just to put it very bluntly, the putting of white folks above all others in society. As a black man, as a cisgendered hood dude who looks hip hop, you know.
Well, we have a president who's black, who's above all others.
Yeah, but we also have 3 times the hate groups because of it. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, we have hate groups.
Yeah, understand this. It's like a black president doesn't mean that black people made some big leap forward.
That means
that white people got to accept a black man as president for the first time. We've had presidential black people since we've been black people. So this is not an advancement for us. This is an advancement for America as a nation. But coupled with Barack Obama being president, we also have 3 times the hate groups. When he even mentions blackness or what black people go through,
what
he gets hated on.
What kind of hate group exists? I never heard of them.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the FBI looks at all kind of hate groups, militia groups, radical armed groups.
It goes both ways, I think.
I don't think so. I think for it to go both ways, you have to have the same foundation. And one is trying to fight for their supremacy. One is trying to fight for their equality. So I don't think it goes both ways. It's not congruent. It's not fighting for the same thing. I think one is fighting to maintain the status quo of oppression of a certain people and a privilege that they get to maintain. And the other group is trying to fight for their belief in their own beauty and their right to be human and be treated as humans equally. And for our young black kids not to be charged as adults 18 times more than white children. And for us to be able to get an equal number of callbacks from a job with an ethnic name like my own. So what we're fighting for, even if black people are so traumatized that they're filled with hate and rage, it's still because people are oppressing them. And that oppression is not equal. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I can be a bigot and I can hate white people, but I can't stop them from getting jobs. You know, I can't stop them from you know, have efficacy in society as they're.
But
they
the thing is, if like you say, black people are only 12%, it's obvious that they have to hire the other 88% who are not black, like Hispanics or
of course,
Chinese.
But this is also taken into account for population, so it's not just like that. For example, black people are 12.6% of the population. We're also the lowest users of marijuana, but we're 56% of those incarcerated for it.
That's unfair.
Actually, in New York State, it's 94.6-something percent.
Okay, so there's definitely a discrimination there.
There's absolutely 100% discrimination since the birth
of
this nation.
Bernie Sanders was trying to speak about that.
Yeah, he was trying to speak about it. But I think what we need as black people is to have our own voices be heard. I would vote for Bernie Sanders. You know, he's pretty cool. He's got some issues, you know.
And he wants to get them all out.
Yeah, I wrote a song for his Robin Hood tax, the Keith Ellison D proposal to put a 0.5% tax.
But he's running as an independent. You can still vote for him.
Yeah, I probably will because I can't vote for Hillary with her support of, you know, the prisoner's bill that put black people under the jail and cut us off from social services, and it was based on racism. And I definitely can't vote for Trump. He's just evil. But, you know, I think the biggest thing and the most important thing is that, you know, we don't, as black people, want people to come donate and give us shoes and give us all these things, give us that. We want our own means of production. We want self-determination. A person who doesn't have a job most likely wants to work. You know, you don't feel fulfilled without that efficacy. So what we want in the black community is to be able to have our own businesses, you know what I mean? And it's especially hard when you have companies that literally last year, like Ford, got sued for charging black and brown people higher rates for their loans. For their cars. This is happening right now. So we have so many different nicks and cuts from oppression and white supremacy that I think that as a whole, that's the biggest thing that I worry about, you know? When I see a cop behind me in my car and I have nothing on me, I've done nothing wrong, my palms still get sweaty.
Because
I've been beaten up by cops several times at gunpoint in my life. And then they dusted me off and said, I apologize. Sorry, we got a call. I had one cop do it on purpose when I was 16.
When? Where?
Well, when I was 16, for example, I worked at the San Francisco League of Urban Gardens right by Alameda Projects. It was a farm. It was my first job. I got my first paycheck, and I was going to go buy video games. And I worked with three other friends, so we all went to the bank to go cash our checks. One friend was making a bank account, so we had to wait in the lobby for him. And it was three of us in the lobby.
That's really shocking to hear.
Yeah, I mean, it was shocking to look outside and see 40 cop cars filling Bayview Plaza with guns drawn, screaming at us.
Who called?
The security guard actually said we were robbing the bank because four black kids going into a bank has to be armed robbery. But not only that, you know, it wasn't...
But you didn't have an arm on you.
No, we were little kids going to buy video games, you know what I'm saying?
That doesn't sound right.
But when you look at the psychology behind this, it's already proven that white people look at black kids as older and more responsible. For example, Tamir Rice, when the caller said this 12-year-old boy was 20, you know, on the phone. He's about a 20-year-old man. He's 12. And white people have been shown to have these internal biases due to conditioning, due to media narratives. If you look at the media, three companies own 90% of hip-hop's platform, right? And Taco Bell owns a lot of the tacos, but we don't think that that's Mexican culture, do we? But 90% of this hip-hop is being produced, and we got to ask who it's marketed to. Matter of fact, 75% of hip-hop is bought by suburban white men between 18 and 24. Mm-hmm. And about 90% of hip-hop that we see, this pathological violence and misogyny and patriarchy and dominance is bought by suburban white people, 90%. So they're buying stereotypes that don't reflect my real culture. And this is so detrimental because as a nation, we're so segregated. Matter of fact, 75% of white people today report not having a person of color for a friend, you know, let alone like a hip-hop black guy like myself. But it doesn't stop them from having opinions. And those opinions come from media representations of black and brown culture, black and brown art. And it's very detrimental. So when I say hello and I walk down the street, people grab their babies. Not because they know black people, but because they've been bombarded by these narratives that they've been selling about my folks for about 500 years now. You know what I'm saying? So what I would like...
So you had three bad experiences.
Oh, yeah. I've had many, many bad experiences. I've had three experiences at gunpoint by cops in San Francisco that ended up with me not going to jail because I did nothing wrong. But I was still beaten up at gunpoint. This happens
to... Did you sue the department?
No, I didn't. Lawsuits and... You know,
take a long time.
I mean, they also take a lot of money and they also don't work. Mm-hmm. Right? We got videotape of a cop shooting a person or choking and strangling them illegally. And it goes to a grand jury trial. Yeah, and the cop walks. It's like lather, rinse, and repeat, you know? Everybody mm-hmm. gets mad, protests. Cop gets non-indicted or they get let off. And then everybody gets protesting again. And then we do it again when the next person gets shot. I've been in that situation where I could have been Tamir Rice. And for young brown and black men in, you know, San Francisco and Oakland, we live this every single day. So 30% of kids in Oakland, according to the CDC, Center for Disease Control, are diagnosed with PTSD. And they don't live in nice neighborhoods. They live in my neighborhoods, you know what I'm saying? And they don't look like other people. They look like me. And that's very, you know, stressful to deal with. I mean, you can see the ramifications with what happened in Dallas, you know? If you oppress an entire community of people, some of those people won't be capable of handling their emotions well. You know what I'm saying? If you oppress an entire community of people, some of those people will advocate violence. That's called probability, you know? It's called math. So when we see this violence, which is abhorrent, you know? I don't like seeing cops die. But when we see that violence, I'm surprised it hasn't happened sooner with all the hate that people endure that somebody hasn't snapped so far. And it's really painful to see what these people are going through.
I'm shocked to hear all this.
Yeah, I'm not shocked anymore. You know, I'm used to this.
Well, there was a standoff on Market Street at Taylor, at Jones and Market this past 3 days.
Yeah.
And the new cops actually did not shoot him. They, because he was holding an arm, they simply sent balls to so this is the new policy of San Francisco to not shoot anymore.
I mean, that should be the policy. I mean, if this, see, what we're getting is lost in this mix between I was scared for my life, so that's okay for me to take anybody's life around me.
That shouldn't be that way.
It's not supposed to be that way. You know, when you look at cops in other countries, like in Great Britain, where there's a video with a guy with a huge sword, and like 20 cops with big old shields rush this guy and disarm him. And here in America, if that was a white guy, it doesn't end up the same way as it is for a black guy. Normally, that black guy is a threat to life, you know, and that's because we're viewed with a certain bias. This stuff has been studied thoroughly and proven that, you know, as a black man with brown skin, I look more dangerous, just period, to everybody in society, to everybody in Western culture. I evoke more emotions of threat.
Of danger.
Of danger, absolutely. And I think I'm a pretty nice guy, but when I stand on the corner, I say, hey, talk to me. The biggest reaction I get from people with babies is that they reach their hand back to grab their baby, or they grab their baby and walk across the street. I told a lady.
Because they're afraid?
Yeah, and I got a smile on. I told a lady, I don't eat babies, I'm full. Thank you. All right.
It's just in their subconscious.
I've literally seen people grab their babies so hard just because I said hi. Because I'm a grassroots organizer, so I stand on street corners in affluent neighborhoods that talk about race and social justice. So I say hello, and I've seen people grab their babies so hard it put them in fight or flight mode.
Oh, it's all in their upbringing.
Yeah, I saw them get scared of black people. You know, I saw them, you know, internalize that. So, I mean, I think what
there's a lot of social issue around that.
Yeah.
Let
me tell you the heart of this, because as a black man from Hunters Point, San Francisco, if I want to get a good loan, and not like a payday loan that's predatory, but if I want to get a good loan, I have to go outside of my community. If I want to get health care that's really good, I have to go outside of my community. If I want to get a great education, once again, I have to go outside the ghetto.
The East Bay?
I live in the East Bay now. I'm from Hunters Point, Third and Plume, about 5 minutes from here. But if I want to get an organic orange, I have to go outside of my community. So when I go outside, I see white people. All the time, you know, for everything. And so I know white people as a social group pretty well. The problem is that for white people, there's no incentive for them to come to the hood and to my community to know who I am. Every white person in San Francisco has their Hunters Point story. Oh, I remember that one time I went to Hunters Point. I've been there that one time, you know. So there's not that much incentive. Me as a black person, I've been out of Hunters Point almost every single day of my life because I have to. There's no resources in my community by design, you know? So there's a disparity in how much we know and trust and understand each other. And that's what I think we're doing with Hip Hop for Change, is actually try to bridge that gap, bring about more cross-cultural communication so I can, number one, get a self-determinative platform for a local brown and black expression in its real sense. And two, stop scaring the heck out of white folks. All right. So when they know us, then they won't be so fearful.
Oh, Okay, well, you're telling me things that are really shocking, although people have been talking about it in the news and all that, but that it happened to you personally is shocking to me because you are a nice guy.
Yeah, it happened to most of my friends who live in Hunters Point as well. You have to understand, it's a police state. It's internal colonialism, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, it is, it is. That's why we don't have all the resources that I mentioned and a lot more. That's why when you look at the automatic license plate readers in Oakland that are supposed to search for stolen cars, they don't do that in the neighborhoods where stolen cars are found the most. They do that in black neighborhoods. And what that means is that they're going up reading license plates and putting boots on people's cars in those neighborhoods, and it's becoming a debtor's prison where they're just basically building up a lot of this finance on the pain and suffering of brown and black people. And to be quite honest, white people do more drugs, they die from drugs more, they commit more larceny, more robbery, more rape, more murder, more mass murder, and they're easier to catch drug dealers. I don't know, you know what I'm saying? So the thing is that the system of justice is being applied to certain people. It's being applied to certain people because it's believable, you know. And the police have been put in these neighborhoods with brown and black people and putting them in jails and prisons in suburban white neighborhoods, creating jobs in these neighborhoods. And those jobs don't want to be taken away, you know what I'm saying? And those people in those communities have no connection to our communities. So when we talk about closing prisons, people say, that's ridiculous, you're going to kill jobs. And I'm saying close prisons because they're built on the backs of brown suffering. We got about a $300 billion industry with a lot of industry surrounding our private prison industry.
They should dismantle that.
Of course. I mean, if we look at incarceration rates, I estimate 70% of people incarcerated are therefore prejudiced. And so how do you get rid of a 70% of a $300 billion system with the best lobby in Congress?
They make money to put people in jail.
Yeah, I mean, they spend way more on private prisoners than they spend on college students.
Are they going to dismantle that?
In order to be able to dismantle a big enough entity like that, we would have to revolutionize our system. I mean, look at how hard it was to get cigarettes like labeled as cancer causing.
Oh.
Yeah, and that was just optics, you know what I'm saying? When you're talking about dismantling a private prison industry, you're literally talking about killing $300 billion worth of jobs, and I think it's like $700 billion worth of surrounding infrastructure.
They live on it.
And they have one of the strongest lobbies in our Congress as well. This is why crack cocaine was 100 times the sentence as powdered cocaine, which is more attributed to white people. When white people do more crack cocaine anyway, they just used to show us doing it all the time.
They just walk, huh?
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, now it's 18 times more, but this is predatory. This is racist. This is an extension of Jim Crow. Read Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow.
Bill Clinton said it was a big mistake to privatize prison, and they should undo that.
But you know what? 2 months ago, when Black Lives Matter folks were protesting him, he also told those black people that they were protecting murderers and rapists.
Who said that?
Bill Clinton did.
He did?
Yeah. So he did not learn a lesson, and he's a horrible person because of that. So he can say that it was a mistake. But when you have Black Lives Matter people protesting, acknowledging that mistake, you can't then, if you've learned, be defensive and say, oh, you guys are wrong, you're just defending murders and rapists, when it's totally apparent that Black Lives Matter is trying to get equality within the application of justice.
And what do you think of the revolution they had in Dallas where they shot innocent people?
That wasn't a revolution. That was an act of terror.
But they killed a Hispanic guy who was just a father.
Well, he's a cop.
Yeah, but he had nothing to do with it.
But if he's a cop and a badge, then that's that guy's enemy. You got to understand, it doesn't matter if he's a Mexican cop. He said he wanted to kill cops, mostly white cops, right?
But he killed one white, but
but he wanted to kill cops. Mm. And preferably white cops.
Oh.
So he wanted to, you got to understand, his issue was against police destruction of black lives.
What about these policemen who never hurt the black people?
Well, if you're a police officer, you're a part of a system and you're complicit in that system.
Ah.
And you have the thin blue veil where police have no repercussions and there's no retribution for people who have been murdered and who have been given injustice by the police system. Police who do whistleblow, they get fired. So the cops, there's no reforming a system that's its own job to reform itself. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So if you're if you are a cop, you are part of a system that is destroying black people. And you have to understand this. I think a lot of people look at these immediate violent acts and immediate loss of life as evil as they are, as abhorrent as they are, you know. But I don't think people take the same note when they look at the death and destruction in the last 500 years of hundreds of millions of black bodies and brown bodies. This is a war that's going on in my community in Hunters Point. When they put a police station and destroyed the culture and arrested everybody and destroyed our culture. And now the black community is being kicked out in droves. This is war. You might want to call it a Cold War. You might want to call it, a capitalist war, but it's a war for us. You know what I'm saying? And when you oppress an entire community, some people will be like this guy who can't handle it and is off his rocker. Because every community has people who have mental problems. Every community has people who are violent. Every community has people who don't care about life, you know? So if you oppress an entire community and somebody pops off and starts killing people, yeah, that is horrible that he did that. But I'm not going to be blinded to this, if this is small instance, to not be able to see the entire war that's creating that anger. All right, my people are dying as we speak, right now, you know, and 560 some people have been shot unarmed by cops this year, and 20 something percent of them were black people, which is a higher rate. Yeah, it's happening right now. And so we have 5 dead cops, and that is sad. And I've been in tears for just
the families,
for everybody, for this whole country, for life, for humanity, for Mother Gaia, you know. But
in 8 years, do you think Obama has done anything?
What can Obama do? He's a centrist. What he did was triple the drone strikes. He approved fracking, and he kept the Patriot Act. He did a lot of cool social stuff, but he didn't change the system of finance and the oligarchy that's destroying our, you know, our sovereignty as a state. He didn't change any of that stuff. He did stuff that was easy.
You think he can change something?
I think we can change something. I can't change anything. I could be shot real easy, but that's why I'm trying to make a nonprofit organization that can maybe consolidate some organizing and consolidate some capital to actually put it the right way. There's only 3 ways to amass capital in America without going to the federal penitentiary, and that's public, and I'd never do that because I don't want to work with the government. They're the problem. The other is private, and I wouldn't want to give all those taxes away for war and bombing brown babies in the Middle East. And the third is nonprofit, where I just pay employee taxes, and we can keep our own stuff and work for our community, and our focus is on bridging gaps and getting a voice to these people. Because when you're talking about being oppressed, I don't need other organizations from on high talking about my oppression. I need my people to feel efficacy, to have connection, to have a platform to speak. And that's what hip-hop is for us. Hip-hop is the voice of the people. And that's why in 1992, the number one song wasn't F the Police on the radio. It was Fight the Power. You know what I'm saying? And that was the voice of our people. And that's what our kids should be hearing, not the fake corporate narrative hip-hop that's being sold 90% to suburban white people that makes us look like pathological idiots. That's not my culture, and that's not what we do. We're mostly really cool people. So if we can give ourselves that platform to speak out and share our knowledge and share our experiences, maybe we could be viewed a little bit better by society, you know? But until then, people will buy what's very easily believed. And to believe that I'm a super predator, as Hillary Clinton said, yeah, that's easy for people. That's what we've been calling people like me for 500 years.
Hmm. Wow, this is so, so shocking. I thought I was going to hear someone sing. And
oh, I will.
We're talking about...
I can. I'll tell you right now.
So when you're going to sing, you're going to sing about that?
I'm going to rap.
When you rap, you're going to rap
about that? I'll rap about police brutality as well. I can rap about organic produce and food justice. Okay. I can rap about the hip-hop industry that's destroying the view and depiction of black and brown culture. I can rap about anything. But I think I'm going to rap about some police brutality and violence because I'm pretty angry
because
right now.
Because it's in the news. Okay. Yeah. So let's move. For you standing or you want to do sitting?
We can do whatever you like.
Okay. So let me...